Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Invisible Hour, a novel by Alice Hoffman. Read by Jessie Mueller.
I began my life for the second time on a June night in the year I turned 15. My name was still Mia Jacob, and I was still made of blood and bones. But when I stepped into the road on that night, I walked into a different future. I left the way my mother had arrived, alone and in the dark. The moon was yellow, and the woods were pitch black. If you didn't know there were mountains and fields, and that this was Western Massachusetts, you would think you had come to the end of the earth. In some ways that was true, at least for me. I could feel every breath that I took rattle inside my chest. Every heartbeat echoed. Freedom is not what you think it is. It's cold and hard and bright. That was what it felt like to change everything. To pick up the ashes and let them blow in the wind. In the morning, I was to be punished out in the cow field, in front of everyone. A cautionary tale so that one and all could see what happened to anyone who disobeyed. I was meant to beg and plead. I had asked to be forgiven in the past, but I was someone else now. I was the girl who knew how to escape, the one who could become invisible, who believed that a single dream was more powerful than a thousand realities. They thought I only had a life that I lived here, but I had found other possibilities every time I read a book. They locked me in the barn with the sheep. They told me I should think about what tomorrow would bring. But I had stolen a hammer from the men rebuilding a shed in the farthest field, and I'd left it underneath the hay in the barn. I'd always thought I might need to escape. I worked on the lock for an hour or more, until my hands were blistering and bleeding. Nothing. And then, all at once, the lock came apart in my hands. I was wearing gray overalls and my mother's red boots. I looked like a prisoner, and that was what I'd always believed I was. But not anymore. My long red hair had been cut as a punishment in the spring, when I would not leave my mother's gravesite and had to be torn away, the ferns I'd held on to still in my hands. My hair was too beautiful anyway, that's what they said. Nothing more than a vanity, the sort of attribute that would make me look in a mirror and think I was better than everyone else. This time the punishment was worse. They had hung a rope around my neck, on which there was a badge announcing the rules I had broken. A for acts of wickedness. A for affront and for anarchy. A for avoidance and antisocial behavior. A for ambition. Tomorrow, they would burn the letter A into my arm, so I would never forget the reason for my punishment. They had found books in my possession. Shakespeare's collected plays, the Blue Book of Fairy Tales, which had been my mother's favorite when she was a girl, Emily Dickinson's letters and poems. I am out with lanterns looking for myself. Every time I had gone to town, I'd managed to sneak into the library. I knew there was magic there, and I knew they would do their best to destroy it. They'd burned my books tonight, and I could still smell the sulfury scent of embers out in the field where they planned to punish me tomorrow. I had one more book, the one I loved best of all, hidden in the barn in a place where they'd failed to look. It was my treasure and my map. It was the book that had saved my life. Long ago, there had been other places where women were punished for being true to themselves. I kept the Scarlet Letter close to my heart when I left the barn and ran across the dark field. Sometimes, when you read a book, it's as if you were reading the story of your own life. That was what had happened to me. I woke up when I read the first page. I saw who I was and who I could be. The only other thing I took with me was a tiny painting I had found in a cabinet in the office. "Take it," Evangeline, who ran the office in the school, had said when she saw what I'd found. "No one wants that junk." It was a watercolor in shades of blue and green that I'd kept beneath my pillow. I looked at it every night, and it always reminded me that the world was beautiful. It was beautiful even in the dark, with the soft green air all around me, and the fireflies drifting through the tall grass, and the white phlox growing wild in the woods. The dogs all knew me, and they didn't stop me when I got to the gate. They didn't even bark. There were bats flickering through the trees. There were so many stars, but I didn't have time to look at them. I walked among the crowded thorns. I stood too close and bled. My mother didn't know how to unlock what kept us here, but I was different. I had the key in my hands, the book that was first published in 1850, the one that understood our story better than anyone who had ever known us. I left the badge that had been strung around my neck behind, making certain to tear it in two. I went through the fields, then down the dirt road and past the old oak trees. In the distance there was High Top Mountain, where bears still roamed. I knew what I had to do. Travel light. Don't look back. Take only what you need most of all. I slipped into the forest and headed toward town. I had been born here and had lived here all my life, but that was over now. I would remain invisible among the ferns and the pine trees, unseen by any passing traffic. Twigs and leaves crunched under my boots as I made my way through the dense greenery where the evergreens gave off a dark, earthy scent. It was the end of something and the beginning of something. In every fairy tale, the girl who is saved is the one who rescues herself. When I came to town, I ran down the road. I ran faster than I ever had before. I went to the one place where I knew the door would be open. The place where I'd found the key. Long before the sun came up, before they went to the barn and found I was gone, before they began to search for me, I was at the library. That was when my life began. Part 1. The Here and Now. Chapter 1. Across the Universe. Ivy came from Boston and had lived her whole life on Beacon Hill, but whenever she was asked where she grew up, she would say, West of the Moon. She laughed when she gave out that fairy tale locale that had never existed in this world or any other, but anyone could tell from the look in her eyes how deeply she wished it were true. She had always felt like an outsider in Lewisburg Square, an exclusive enclave of Greek Revival houses surrounding a small park and garden, all privately owned by the elite families in the city. Neighbors didn't necessarily speak to each other, but they respected one another, and they followed the rules. The other girls on the hill wore pleated skirts and blouses with Peter Pan collars. They did as they were told, and when they graduated from the Birch School, they went to Wellesley or Mount Holyoke. Ivy was different. She did as she pleased. Her parents didn't appreciate the way she sulked, or how she shamed herself with her short skirts, treating her beauty as if it were a curse, chopping off her hair one year and dyeing it blue another, storming out of the room whenever her parents tried to talk sense into her. All the same, she was an intelligent girl and had always been a great reader, spending hours at the Boston Athenaeum. But despite her love of books, she ignored her schoolwork and was failing her classes, bored to death by her lessons. She loved Thoreau for his rebellious thoughts and the Brontes for their dark and tragic tales of love, and Toni Morrison, whose novels made her cry and feel as if she didn't know the first thing about life. What few treasures she had were stored in a small jewelry box she'd been given when she was a child. When the lid was opened, a dancer spun in a circle. Inside, there were little more than trinkets, silver bangle bracelets, a ticket stub from a concert she'd gone to when her parents were away vacationing, the key to their maid Helen Connolly's house. Helen, who'd never had children and always regretted that decision, saw the family close up, and she knew how unhappy Ivy was. She'd been with the Jacob family ever since Ivy was a toddler and thought of the girl as her own, even though she wasn't. If she had been, Ivy would have been pulled out of that private school where she was so clearly failing. She'd know she was loved. "For emergencies," Helen had said when she gave Ivy the key. "If you ever need me." Ivy had thrown her arms around Helen to thank her. "Every day is an emergency," Ivy had whispered, and although she had smiled, it didn't feel like a joke. "Don't forget," Helen had told the girl. "Day or night, I'm here." Ivy was a true beauty, with black hair and gray eyes, but as she grew older, she became more unmanageable, at least in her parents' opinion. By the time she was 16, her mother considered Ivy to be the bane of her existence. When she was a senior in high school, her grades were abysmal. She often slept past noon, and she'd become a vegetarian, a choice her parents were convinced she had made out of spite. Ivy had been picked up by police with a group that had vandalized the statue of John Harvard in Harvard Yard, painting his foot red. There had been one boy after another, and Ivy had recently been caught in her room in bed with a neighbor's son, a Harvard student named Noah Brinley, who was from a perfectly fine family. Still, their actions were unacceptable. Noah's parents were not informed of the situation. Boys would be boys, after all. But Ivy was grounded for several weeks, although if her parents had been more observant, they would have seen damp footprints on the carpeting in the hall, left there on the cold mornings when Ivy sneaked back into the house after nights spent in the public garden or in Noah's dorm room, or wandering home along Beacon Street. Ivy didn't realize what had happened until September, and by then, 3 months had passed. She'd skipped her time of the month before, but one day she felt something move inside her. No one had discussed birth control with her, and she thought she could depend on Noah to take care of that, but he'd never been one to take responsibility. Now, it was as if she had swallowed the sea, and there was a wave coursing through her, a quickening that felt as if another heart was beating against her own. Ivy had never thought about having a baby. Children were of no interest to her, but now, what was important in the world had changed. Students were just returning to Harvard, and she found Noah in his dorm room unpacking. He'd been away all summer, traveling with his parents in France, and somehow he had not connected with Ivy after his return to the States. The truth was, there were other girls he found more interesting, ones who didn't have so much baggage, and were more sophisticated in sexual matters. Noah was tall and handsome, with thick red-blonde hair. "Hey," he said uncertainly when he saw her in the doorway. Ivy looked heavier, and she had a strange dreamy expression, almost as if she was in a trance.
"What are you doing here?" Noah asked after a measured pause.
She was there to tell him that their lives were about to change, that they were meant to be together, that joy would be theirs. But when she announced that she was pregnant, Noah had no response. He appeared blank and fuzzy-headed, the way he did when he'd had too much to drink. Ivy told him she wanted them to run away together, and in response, Noah slammed the door shut in case his roommate returned.
"Lower your voice," he said,
and at that moment, there in his Harvard dorm room, he sounded like Ivy's father. Ivy had thought they were in love. That's what they had told each other. But now she saw the dark, sidelong look Noah gave her, and she thought that she might have been wrong. She'd seen that look before, from her father, as a matter of fact. Disappointment and distance. Noah was still in the room with her, but it was as if he'd already left.
"Do you think I would actually consider running away?" Noah said coldly, a scowl on his handsome face. "This is my sophomore year. This year matters. Don't screw it up for me."
Ivy felt like a little girl, abandoned to a world of chaos. The truth was, for all of her bad girl attitude, Noah was the first boy she'd been intimate with. She couldn't go to her family.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.